Okay, I guess we can start. Well, first of all, thank you very much for coming. So I will be talking for 8 hours, not today, but and my goal is to tell you a little bit about sharp threshold phenomena in statistical physics, at least the mathematical understanding of it. And actually, between the time where I chose the title and between today, we made some good progress. So I will actually focus on a special case, which is a Potts model, and try to go through the complete proof. Now, rather than starting right away, while you are still cold and so on, I thought that I would start by first 2 hours of lecture, where I will try to motivate to you why this is a good question, a natural question, that you don't have to take my word for it. And then I will go through the proof. So this lecture is going to be some kind of motivation, try to explain to you that in particular it allows you to compute what we call critical points. Then in the next lecture, I will actually take a simple case that maybe most of you maybe already saw, which is a case of Bernoulli percolation. And I will prove in two different ways sharpness for percolation. But the first proof is very simple, and some already saw it in their class, probably in master, but I will do it a little bit differently anyway. The second proof is completely new. And you may think at first that it's not so interesting because the first proof is much simpler than the second one. But it gives you another type of information, and this second proof has the advantage of being much more general. So I will present it first in the case of Bernoulli percolation, that you don't get lost in the formalism. But then in the third and fourth lecture, I will actually explain to you how you prove it, I mean how you extend this proof and make it work, say, for Potts model, and also maybe I will see maybe other type of model of statistical physics, depending on what you prefer. Okay, so today it's a motivation. And I want to motivate this, so I should say that it's mostly joint work with Vincent Befara for what I'm going to talk about today, Vincent Tassion and Aran Raoufi for what I will talk about in the other lectures. And if you have any question, you don't understand anything, right, you ask Aran, who is here. He will be very glad to answer you. And he is responsible for all the steps that are not clear in the proof. Okay, so introduction. And the question is going to be, how do we compute the critical points? I mean, how do you compute the critical point of your favorite model? So my favorite model is Bernoulli percolation, so we are going to start with this one. So Bernoulli percolation it's a model of random subgraph of the square lattice. I'm going to focus on Z2 just because we have a finite amount of time for the lectures, so let's start on Z2. I will maybe at the end explain to you how you can do for other cases. So for Bernoulli percolation, imagine you have your square lattice. And Bernoulli percolation is a model of random subgraph of the square lattice. So every edge in your square lattice, so let's denote the set of edges of the square lattice E. For any edge, well, E is going to belong, so omega E is going to be equal to 0 or 1 with the following interpretation. If omega E equals 0, we think of it as closed or absent of our subgraph. And if omega E is 1, we think of it as open or present in our subgraph. So a configuration omega at the end is just a subgraph of the square lattice where every the set of vertices is a set of original vertices of the square lattice, and the set of edges is a set of open edges, or if you want, it's a set of E for which omega E is equal to 1. Okay? So now the distribution on the model, so it's, I want to take it at random, so the probability of a configuration, omega, will be a random subgraph. And simply what we do is that omega E is equal to 1 with probability P, and it's equal to 0 with probability 1 minus P, independently for every edge, where the state are independent. I know I'm writing fairly fast on the board, so just one advice is everything you already know, you don't have to write it on your piece of paper like that. You will not get delayed. Okay, so this is probably you already saw Bernoulli percolation in your life. You know that there is a critical point. You are interested in the connectivity properties of this random subgraph. So there exists a P, which is between 0 and 1, such that, well, the probability that 0 is connected to infinity, which I would denote like that, so the probability that 0 is in an infinite connected component, is 0 if P is smaller than PC, and is strictly positive, and I will call it theta of P, if P is larger than PC. So there is a phase transition. The larger the P, the more edges I have in my random subgraph. It's fairly natural to expect that there is a critical point above which you will have an infinite cluster with positive probability, and below which you don't have an infinite cluster with positive probability. Okay, so Bernoulli percolation, it was introduced by Broadbent and Hammersley in the 50s. But somehow the following theorem had to wait for the 80s to be proved. And the theorem is due to Kesten, and it also had to wait for Kesten to be proved, which is also an important piece of information. So Kesten in the 80s proved that PC is equal to 1/2. And I want to discuss a little bit what is the path to go to such a theorem. What is difficult, what is easy, etc., etc. So let's start by, level zero reasoning, or minus one, I don't know, which is to try to guess what it is. Why it should be 1/2? Why predicting PC equal 1/2? And in order to do that, we are going to notice a duality relation for Bernoulli percolation. So if I take my original lattice, I can define a dual graph by putting a vertex in the middle of every face of my lattice and by putting edges between nearest neighbors. So for every edge E, I will denote the only edge that is crossing it by E star. Okay, so this edge here is going to be denoted E star. Okay, so if I have a configuration on my lattice, let's say I take something with this open, let's say something like that, I can naturally define a dual configuration by saying that an edge is open in the dual configuration if the corresponding edge of the primal configuration is closed. So for instance, this edge is not present in the first configuration, so I will make it present in the dual one. Similarly here, this is going to be present, this is going to be present, and so on. On the contrary, when the edge is present in the primal configuration, I don't put it in the dual one. Okay? So this dual configuration is defined properly like that. Omega star of E star, of the edge E star, is equal to 1 minus omega of E. So it's open if the other one is closed, and closed if the first one is open. Now, if omega is simple according to Bernoulli percolation of parameter P, I should have said here we are going to denote the measure by like that. If omega is simple according to this, then omega star, well, it's simple according to a Bernoulli percolation measure of parameter 1 minus p, right? Each edge is open with probability 1 minus p because it's exactly the probability that this guy is closed. So here I'm cheating. I mean, this is not quite true because it's on the dual lattice, but so it's kind of on the dual of the two. But now we see that there is one parameter which plays a very specific role, which is the parameter for which 1 minus p is equal to p, which is 1 half. So the level zero of rigor to prove that p is equal to 1 half is to say, well, there should be a unique point where something weird is happening. And if pc is not equal to pc star, then there should be something weird happening at pc, but also at 1 minus pc. Okay? So kind of the first reasoning is some kind of uniqueness of a critical point should lead to p equal 1 minus p, meaning pc equal 1 half. So I see many faces that don't seem very convinced, and I understand. This is a level zero. We are not going to stay at this level of reasoning. But this is the first one somehow. And it is actually the true guess, right? So this is typically how a physicist would start to study the thing. He would try to first to see what is a good candidate. And this would be his first argument. Then he will go farther, but this is the first argument. OK, but it's fairly weak argument still. So, okay, this was our first day of school, second day of school. We are going to try to get something a little bit more precise. And the first reasoning that we can do is the following. Say, okay, assume that PC is smaller than 1 half. So assume that you are here. So if you are here, this 1 minus pc is here. So if you do that, you know, you observe that here there is no infinite connected component. Let's call a connected component of our graph, let's call it a cluster, because I'm going to anyway use this often. So no infinite cluster in omega in this regime. There is an infinite cluster here. So there, infinite cluster. But here, there is no infinite cluster in omega star. And here, there is an infinite cluster in omega star. So that implies, if you do it like that, if you think this is what is happening, it implies that there is a whole range here of parameters for which there is both an infinite cluster in omega and an infinite cluster in omega star. And if you think about it, this seems to be very difficult to happen. Because of the construction of omega and omega star, not having an infinite cluster in both, I mean, having an infinite cluster in both kind of implies that you should have an infinite interface. And this seems to be difficult. So if you assume, and this is going to be our hypothesis, if you assume that there is no coexistence of infinite clusters in omega and omega star, well, then this must imply that PC is larger or equal to 1 half. So H1 implies PC larger or equal to 1/2. Let's go the other way now. And by the way, this hypothesis is kind of decent to believe if you think of the infinite cluster as some kind of huge cluster omnipresent, like almost everywhere. Then it seems to be even really completely impossible that in the dual you would have exactly the same cluster kind of coexisting. You can try to do the same by assuming that PC is larger or equal to 1/2. Then 1 minus PC is on this side. And if you do the same reasoning, what do you end up with? You end up with a whole regime here for which you have no infinite cluster in the primal and in the dual configuration. So if you assume, and this is again some kind of hypothesis, if you assume that there is no regime for which omega and omega star do not have infinite clusters, then again, this second hypothesis must imply that PC, this time, is smaller or equal to 1/2. But these two hypotheses, a priori, they have no, I mean, they are not that clear. In fact, there are models for which these things could fail. So this is a level one of reasoning, but it's still far from a proof. So really, this level one comes really from the idea that if there is no infinite cluster in one configuration, there should be one in the other, and vice versa. It's a good, I mean, it's a decent thing to believe, but it's not a priori clear. OK, so let's do one more step of reasoning, try to evolve a little bit more. And let's look at the following event. Look at the event that the box n by n plus 1 contains a path from left to right in omega. OK? So what is the probability of this event at 1/2? Well, the probability of this event plus the probability of its complement is equal to 1. And the probability of the complement is not that difficult to estimate, because the complement is exactly if you do not have a path from left to right, then there must be a dual path in the dual configuration going from top to bottom in this dual graph here that you obtain by taking this graph like that. Okay? The point being that this graph, this rotated version, this dual graph is a n by n plus 1 rectangle in that direction, and I'm asking for a crossing for the dual configuration, which also has distribution Bernoulli percolation with parameter 1/2. So this event and this event, they simply have the same probability. So these two things are equal, and they sum to 1. So it implies that the probability of this thing is equal to 1/2. OK. So why is it interesting to have this estimate? Well, we can try to get assumption, to make hypotheses. If P is larger than PC, well, it's pretty decent to believe you have this infinite cluster. So this infinite cluster, if it's fairly big, it has a good chance to contain, in particular, one path which is going to cross from left to right this rectangle. So the first hypothesis that I could do is to assume that for any p larger than pc, the probability of this crossing event is tending to 1 as n tends to infinity. This seems to be a decent hypothesis. There's a second hypothesis that one could do, which is you could assume that the opposite happens, so when p is smaller than pc, meaning that this probability would go when n tends to infinity to 0. If you have these two hypotheses, then it's automatic that this guy, 1/2, cannot be above pc or below pc, so it means that 1/2 must be equal to pc. Okay? Problem again is that it's not that clear how you justify such a claim. But at least one of the two hypotheses is provable. So this was theorem 1.1. I'm going to try to keep track of this, but I mean, I don't have big hopes there. But so proposition 1.2 is that indeed h prime 1 is true, meaning when p is larger than pc, necessarily the crossing probability is going to tend to 1. OK. So let's prove that. And I'm going to make two assumptions, two things that I'm not going to justify, but which are completely basic knowledge in percolation theory, which is going to be the following two things. So the first thing is that either there is no infinite cluster, or when there is an infinite cluster, then it's unique. And it's almost surely unique. So when an infinite cluster exists, it exists almost surely, and it's unique. So this is a fairly standard claim. For those who don't know about it, they can come and ask me at the end. And the second thing is also going to be standard, is the FKG inequality, which says the following. Say that an event A is increasing if, when I take two configurations and one is smaller than the other one, so there are fewer edges in the first one, then omega belongs to A implies omega primes belong to A. So that means somehow it's an event which is stable by adding edges in my configuration. Okay? So typically, the existence of a path from left to right, if I add open edges, I remain, of course, in my event. So A is increasing if you have that. And the FKG inequality says that for any AB which are increasing events, the probability of A intersected with B is larger or equal to the probability of A times the probability of B, which you can reinterpret if you divide by the probability of B. You can say probability of A knowing B is larger or equal to the probability of A. So conditionally on having an increasing event, other increasing events are more likely to occur, which is natural because somehow increasing events are events that enjoy having open edges. So if B occurs, it kind of gives you information that there are open edges in my configuration. So it makes the second event more likely to happen. I mean, I need to juggle between the fact that there are master students and there are people who now think that master students, I mean, their master was many years ago. So I will try to not to give too much details, but at the same time to provide sufficiently that everybody can follow. OK, so these are my two assumptions. These one are not going to prove them. Now, how do we conclude the proof? First thing that we are going to do is take a box of size k, let's call it lambda k, in the middle of my box of size n. So I already put it in the middle. So this is n plus 1 by n. And first thing I want to say is that let's put it in the middle of a box n by n, sorry. First thing I want to say is that I want to look at the probability that there is a path from this small box. Imagine k much smaller than n, right? In your head, think of that. I want a path from the small box to the left of my big box, which is staying inside the box. So probability at P of having that. Okay. Well, I claim that this is larger or equal to 1 minus the probability of having a path from the small box to the boundary to the power 1/4. Okay, so this could look a little bit weird, but think of the following. If you do not have this, so the probability that there is not a path from the center to the left, call this event A1. It's a decreasing event in the sense that it's the opposite of an increasing event. It's the complement of an increasing event. By the way, here, if you put decreasing, here you get the same inequality for decreasing events. Right? Simply, you pass to the complement and you get the same. So, assume, so call A1 the event that there is no path from the center to the right, to the left, sorry, that's the left. Take A2 to be the event that there is nobody from the center to the top, A3 to the right, and A4 to the bottom. The event that there is no path from the center to anywhere on the boundary is the intersection of the four events. But these four events are decreasing. So if I use the FKG inequality not for two but for four events, so you use it just three times, you are going to get that the probability of the intersection of the four events is larger than the product of the probabilities. So it's larger than the probability of not having a path to the power 4. Okay? Well, when you pass to the complement, it exactly tells you the probability of having a path is larger than 1 minus the probability of having a path to the whole thing to the power 1/4. That's called the square root trick. I don't want to spend too much time on that. But here, this is just even larger than 1 minus the probability that the box of size k is connected to infinity to the power 1/4. So in particular, okay, where is the eraser? So maybe I don't want to, I guess everybody wrote that. So I'm going to carry on here. So now, what is the probability? So I take my box n by n plus 1. I have my box lambda k here, and I just take the translate by 1 of this box. Let's call it lambda prime k. Okay? What is the probability that there is, from this box, a path there, and from the other box, a path there? Well, these are two increasing events, so the probability of that is larger than the product of the probabilities. So this is larger, actually you don't even need there, you can just do the union bound if you want, but it's larger than this. Right? So either you use FKG or you just use a complement and do union bound. Okay, why do I want to prove that? Simply because when n tends to infinity, well, these two paths have no reason a priori to be connected to each other, right? There may be here, there may be something, some dual surface blocking, making these two clusters disjoint. But the whole point is that when n tends to infinity, I told you that there is a unique infinite cluster almost surely. So this will imply automatically that when I take the lim, let's take lim inf if we want, the lim inf of the probability of crossing n by n plus 1, like that. Well, because the probability of having two disjoint paths from the box of size k to infinity is 0, Well, the probability of this when n tends to infinity is going to be the same as the probability of a crossing from n to n plus 1. The difference between having a crossing from this box and having these two paths which potentially are not connected to each other is exactly this event that there are two disjoint paths going from this small box to the big box. And this event goes to zero because we know that almost surely there is a unique infinite cluster. So that implies that this thing, the lim inf of this, is larger or equal to this quantity. Right? So this thing is using uniqueness. It's just using that here I want to replace by there is a crossing from left to right. What is the error I'm doing? Well, the error is included in the event that there are two disjoint paths from the box of size k to distance n. And this tends to 0 when n tends to infinity. OK, so I do that. But now notice that, yeah.
Why did you need this small box? Why was it not enough to, say, take a point instead of this lambda k, lambda k?
That's going to be for the next step, which is now when k tends to infinity, because there is an infinite cluster almost surely, just measurability tells you that this probability goes to Do not hesitate to stop me, especially when I do crazy things. This was not having anything. So this thing, when k tends to infinity, it just goes to 0. So just let k tends to infinity. What did I get? I get that this lim inf must be equal to 1. So I just proved that this thing is converging to 1, which was what I wanted. So this step of, so here I really want to highlight the fact that this probability tends to 1 when p is larger than pc is really relying on very few things. It's relying on the uniqueness of the infinite cluster and the FKG inequality. Some people may have, I feel like it was not convincing at all looking at your faces. That's, anyway, it happens. So corollary of this is that PC, well, since I have assumption H1, this implies that PC must be larger or equal to 1/2. So the moral of the story is that proving a lower bound on the critical point is not the end of the world. Well, it was maybe for you, but if you go back and look at it a little bit more in detail, it's not the end of the world. So, yeah. So this thing is not difficult somehow. Making sense of not having two infinite clusters somehow, I mean, the equivalent of this is not that difficult. The problem is making sense of the other one. And this is not that easy. OK. So let's go to level 3 of reasoning. Which is more of a detour than really important for what we are going to do next. So it's really to give you an idea of how the historical proofs went. So what is a phase transition? A phase transition is a sharp change of behavior in macroscopic quantities of your system. So there is one which we enjoy quite much, is if I look at a ball of size n, if I look at a box of size n, well, or n plus 1, say, well, a macroscopic quantity of my system could be, is there a cluster which is crossing this box or not? OK, so let's call this probability as a function of p. Let's call it fn of p. And can I say anything relevant on the graph of this function? I could make you participate there. So you know that here it's 1/2. I just proved it to you. Here it's 0. Here it's 1. Up to now, everybody is following, I guess. And in between, how does it look? Well, in between, it's going to look like that. And this is the important thing. It's going to be very close to 1, then drop to 1/2, get very close to 0, and stay very close to 0. Oh, wow, that was nice. For a long time. Do not ask me to redo this drawing. Okay. So there is a sharp threshold, a brusque change of behavior, in the sense that if you look at, say, a level 1 minus epsilon and a level epsilon, well, the window here between the first time you reach epsilon and the first time you reach 1 minus epsilon, this spacing here, delta p, well, this delta p is tending to 0 as n is tending to infinity. So delta p tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. So this is what you expect. That would be exactly a phase transition, a brusque change in my behavior. But you need to prove that. And a priori, it's not that trivial. So,
Thank you, Ben.
You could expect. So actually, it's going to be a continuous phase transition because this is not the probability that 0 is connected to distance n.
Okay.
So this one, we will see that theta n of p, which is. So let's make a just parenthesis because that's a good question. If you define this person, which this is just 0 connected to distance n, this one is going to change continuously. And theta n, something like that. This is a continuous function. And in particular, even its limit theta of p is also going to vary continuously. But here, we are really looking at another type of guy, which is 0 is in between, is in the middle. And a priori, 0 has no reason to even be on this crossing. And typically, it won't be on the crossing. Okay, so how could we prove something like that? So there is a theorem, which I will call theorem 1.4, but which is more of a meta theorem than anything. I will not give a name for who proved it first, because all the proofs are actually based on this observation, is that there exists a constant such that, well, for any n and for any p, when I look at the derivative of fn at p, well, it's larger than a constant times, well, fn of p, 1 minus fn of p. Okay, this first is kind of natural if you think about it. The derivative, when fn of p is close to 0, when your function is close to 0 or it is close to 1, you cannot expect your derivative to stay big. So this is just a natural quantity to introduce there. But the important thing is that in front of that, you have another term, which is log n. I wanted to highlight it, and I just realized I chose the worst color for that. On the board, anyway, log n. So why is it good? Well, because if you think about it, imagine, so we know that at 1/2, it is 1/2, the probability. But we can also, this can be integrated to show exactly that necessarily we have a behavior like that. So I want to do the integration because we are not going to work with this type of thing, but we are going to work with something similar in the next lectures. So how do you integrate kind of differential inequality like that? Well, you observe that this is fn prime over fn 1 minus fn, which is exactly the derivative of this function. And this thing is larger than C log n for every p. So when I integrate that between p and p plus epsilon, what do I get? I'm writing that you can think in your head. And, okay, so what do I get? I get that, and I'm going to think by looking at my book. Okay? Fn of p plus epsilon over 1 minus fn of p plus epsilon is going to be larger or equal to n to the c times epsilon times fn of p over 1 minus fn of p. Right? It's exactly what you get when you integrate this inequality. Now, well, let's plug in that we know that at 1 half, fn of p, fn of 1 half is 1 half. So what do we get? We get that fn, so fn of 1 half plus epsilon divided by 1 minus fn of 1 half plus epsilon is larger than n to the c epsilon times 1, if you put this for p equal 1 half. Fn of 1 half plus epsilon is smaller or equal to 1. So if I put this there and I pass this on the other side, I get that fn of 1 half plus epsilon is larger or equal to 1 minus 1 over n to the c epsilon. And if I do the same in the other direction, if I imagine that p plus epsilon is 1 half, this is equal to 1. This is always smaller or equal to 1. So I get 1 half minus epsilon is smaller than 1 over n to the c epsilon. So this gives me exactly this type of behavior for the crossing probability. Okay? Notice that the window here, the epsilon, is going to be 1 over log n in this case, roughly, which is actually very far from the truth. The truth is, in fact, 1 over n to some power. So it's much, I mean, it's a very weak statement, if you want. But if your goal was to try to prove, I mean, to make, for instance, the step L2 of our reasoning valid, this is sufficient to at least prove that above 1 half and below 1 half, probabilities do not stay bounded away from 0 and 1. They tend to 1 or they tend to 0. The problem is that it was not at all what we wanted anyway. We wanted to prove that if you are below PC, your probability goes to 0. That was the missing step, the H2 that we didn't justify. So this is not quite sufficient. But in fact, by working a little bit more, you can make it happen. You can prove that indeed similar reasoning give you what you want. Let me just tell you a little bit how you get this inequality. So that's exactly the type of inequality that Kesten proved to get his theorem. And Kesten, what he did is just he didn't have like a big theoretical background on what I will discuss next. He didn't have this at his disposal, so he just did it by hand. This derivative of this event has a geometric interpretation in terms of what we call expected number of pivotals. And it just proved that there are the expected number of pivotals is larger than that by hand. And it's a pretty tricky proof. It's really like difficult. So Kesten did it by hand. And there are several alternative ways of getting it by hand. But it's difficult. Somebody did a little bit more conceptual proof of that, and I think it's a beautiful proof, and it's also appealing from the physical point of view, I think, even though it's relying on a kind of mysterious math result. So Bolobash and Riordan observe that one theorem from actually the theory of Boolean functions could be used here. And this theorem is the following. So, I mean, again, this is kind of a detour. If you don't like it, you can just rest for a second and come back with me later on. So it's a theorem which, I mean, you can find on different forms. So, I mean, sometimes it's called BKKKL for Bourguin, Kahn, Katnetzol, Kalai, and Lineal. Or it was also proved on a slightly, I mean, I think maybe the form I'm going to describe is actually due to Talagrand. And it says the following. If you take A increasing, and you look at the derivative of A, well, this is larger or equal to a constant C, which depends on nothing. The probability of A times 1 minus the probability of A. So this is exactly this thing, right? Times the logarithm of 1 over the maximal over every edge of the following thing, what we call the inference of the edge A and the inference is just the probability that the event occurs if omega e is equal to 1 minus the probability that it occurs if omega e is equal to 0. So for people who know percolation theory, it's probability that A is pivotal. Okay. I'm not sure that this is very appealing as it is, but notice the following thing. So the proof of this is using Fourier analysis, discrete Fourier analysis, hypercontractivity. It's not an elementary result. This, I mean, if you remove this log, it is elementary, but if, I mean, having it with this log is very difficult. So this gain, this logarithmic gain, is very important. But what I just want to illustrate, because I really think it's a beautiful argument of Bolobash and Riordan, and somehow what I'm going to tell you next is that we don't need it, which is a little bit disappointing, because I really, I mean, that's the reason why I started in this area. So the observation of Bolobash and Riordan is the following. Take an event A, imagine you are on the torus. That doesn't change, you are with Bernoulli percolation. So, I mean, just work on a torus if you prefer. And imagine that your event A is invariant under translations. So, this is typically not an event which is invariant under translation, but it's pretty close to one. You can think of on your torus, there exists, say, a cluster of radius n, something like that. This will be an event which is invariant under translations. If you think of an event which is invariant under translations, well, somehow all the inferences of the horizontal edges are the same, and all the inferences of the vertical edges are the same, just by invariance under translation. But if this is true, then you see that, well, either all the inferences are small, or they are all big. For A, which is invariant under translations, let's say we are on the torus, then you have two cases, either inferences of E of A is smaller than 1 over n to the epsilon for E vertical and, is larger than 1 over n to the for, say, vertical edges. But if this is true, you have n squared vertical edges. Therefore, the derivative, the derivative of your event, which is in fact the sum of the inferences. This thing is larger than n squared times 1 over n to the epsilon. So it's in fact much larger than log n times the probability of A, 1 minus probability of A. This is called Rousseau formula. I mean, we will not use it anyway. If the inferences of A is larger than 1 over n to the epsilon for E, which is horizontal, well, the same argument gives you a very large derivative. So what remains is the case where both are smaller than 1 over n to the epsilon. But that means the maximal inference is smaller than 1 over n to the epsilon. So the log of this is going to be log n. Both, I mean, max inference and you get the log n from the theorem. So this is for events that are invariant of the translations, but Bolobash and Riordan found a clever way of applying it basically to this event and prove that this guy has a sharp threshold. You see, this theorem I like because it's really telling you, I mean, quantities which are kind of macroscopic in physical systems, they are kind of homogeneous. You imagine that they are the same roughly at every place in your system. So that really tells you that they undergo sharp phase transitions. It's a very general fact of these quantities. Okay. Problem is, as I said, that's not quite justifying anything in our theorem. That's how they proved it, but because here there is a lot of work to be done from this theorem to actually get PC equal 1/2. So this, I don't want to describe this because I'm going to describe to you something much simpler. Okay, let me just also tell you one, make another remark, which is, where is it? I erased it, I guess. Which is that the probability here, when I move by epsilon, the probability is decaying polynomially fast. And when I move by epsilon, it's going to 1 polynomially fast. So in this is not going to be sufficient for us. And we want now the last step of reasoning, L4, which is going to be the following. If I want to conclude the proof of PC equal 1/2, it's sufficient for me to prove the following, which I'm going to call exp. So exp is the following. It's for any p smaller than PC, there exists a constant such that theta n of p, which is the probability that 0 is connected to the boundary of the ball of size n. So this is really ball of size n. Well, this thing decays exponentially fast. Imagine I have this thing. So kind of in the previous step, I told you, well, maybe if you work a lot, you have a chance in some cases to prove polynomial decay. But imagine I give you exponential decay for any p smaller than pc. Well, then I can conclude simply because, so corollary 1.6, pc has to be smaller or equal to 1/2. And the way I'm going to prove that is I'm going to use this thing to tell you, well, the probability of having a crossing from n to n plus 1 where this thing is definitely smaller, I need one point on the left to be connected to distance n, at least, actually even n plus 1. So this is smaller or equal to n times theta n of p, right? Well, if this decays exponentially fast, this goes to 0 as n tends to infinity. for any p smaller than pc. So for p smaller than pc, that is smaller than that, and this by exp is going to 0. In fact, here I could have any rate of decay which is larger than, I mean, faster than 1 over n, would give me that the crossing probability goes to 0, and that would be sufficient. Okay? So of course, I mean, this seems to be a hammer to kind of try to kill a fly. But at the end, all the proofs of exponential decay, all the proof of pc equal 1/2 kind of goes through proving something like that. Or at least it's very simple to deduce that from the different proofs. So this is the first appearance of this condition, and I hope that at least for the square lattice, all this fuzzy discussion before shows to you that there is no real simple way of going around proving a statement like that to try to compute pc. Okay, but maybe your favorite model is not Bernoulli percolation. In fact, my favorite model is not really Bernoulli percolation, but maybe it's the Ising model. So B, let's look at what the Ising model is. So I'm not proving to you exponential decay. I'm going to try to justify for another example that it's a useful thing to prove. OK, so take a finite graph, which is a subset of Z2. And for this graph, I'm going to call sigma a spin configuration, where it's just going to be a collection of plus or minus one random variables, which are assigned to the vertices of my graph. Okay? So sigma x is called the spin at the vertex x, and it's just either plus one or minus one. Or sometimes I will use plus or minus one or just plus minus. Okay, two things are the same. Now, if I take either zero or plus, I'm going to define the Hamiltonian, so the energy of, I mean, how many people did already see the Ising model? Maybe I should start by that. Okay, I should actually start. Who didn't see it? Really, I can jump? Matan, I'm not trusting you on this one. Okay, there are at least one person, and I'm certain that there are three or four people who are just like, oh, I cannot say it. So I'm still going to define it quickly. So the energy of a configuration is going to be minus the sum of sigma x, sigma y for edges in my graph, minus sum of the indicator function that sigma x is equal to 0 or to plus when x is on the boundary of my graph. So the boundary of my graph, just the vertices, suggest there is y which is not on the vertices, and xy is an edge of the original square lattice. So think of, because I'm a subgraph of the square lattice, this makes sense. And here, notice, so the indicators and boundary spins are equal to plus or to 0. So if I put 0, this quantity is always 0, so this second term doesn't exist. And if I put plus, this term is counting the number of spins on the boundary, which are plus. Okay, so this is the energy of a configuration, the Hamiltonian. And then I'm going to pick sigma at random by taking the Gibbs measure with either zero boundary condition or plus boundary condition, which is attributing probability to sigma, which is proportional to minus beta times the Hamiltonian of the configuration. And here I need to renormalize if I want something which is a probability measure. Okay? Well, it's very good that you saw that. So plus boundary condition and the zero boundary condition, we usually call them free boundary conditions. So there is a beta C, there is a critical point, such that, well, when I look at, oh, sorry, and of course, here I had to work in finite volume if I wanted to define the energy, not to have an infinite sum of plus minus. But I can take measure in infinite volume to just be the limit when g tends to z2, so the limit in terms of measures, so the weak limit of measures in finite volume. Okay, so now there is a phase transition. Which is saying the following. When I look at the average spin at zero, it's either zero if beta is smaller than beta c, and it's positive if beta is larger than beta c. And there is a theorem due to Onzager, which says the following. Well, beta c is one half of logarithm of 1 plus square root 2. So question, how do we prove that? So let's go back to level 0. It's going to go faster this time. So level 0, is to go back to exactly, so for percolation, we had the duality relation. Well, for the Ising model, there was a relation, also a duality relation, due to Kramers and Vanier, which says the following. Set beta star such that hyperbolic tangent of beta star is e to the minus 2 beta. Well, if you choose this beta star, you have a relation which is that the free energy, which is simply the limit when g tends to infinity of 1 of, or let's say when n tends to infinity of 1 over bn log of the partition function. So it's not completely clear that this exists, but for people who don't know already this, I recommend that they go, I mean, it's done in any good book about statistical physics. So this free energy is satisfying so that the free energy at beta star is equal to the free energy at beta plus log 2 plus 2 log of the cosh of beta star minus 2 beta. So it's not that I love, you know, complicated formulas. I actually usually hate them. But this formula is saying something very important, is that if you believe that there is a direct correspondence between phase transition and singularities of the free energy, which is something that is believed in physics, at least in generic cases, well, there, if you want a unique phase transition, exactly what I kind of mentioned for Bernoulli percolation, if you want the phase transition to be unique, here it really gets rephrased into there should be a unique singularity for the free energy. Now, if there is a singularity at beta, just because all of this is smooth, it tells you that there is a singularity at beta star by this Kramers-Vanier duality. So what does it imply? It implies that beta c should be equal to beta star c. So uniqueness of singularity should give you that beta c equals beta c star. Note that here, I mean, a priori, the correspondence between singularities and critical points is not completely clear a priori mathematically, and uniqueness of the critical points in this sense of uniqueness of singularity is not clear either. But if you believe that, then you should have beta c equal beta c star, and normally if I did the right thing, it gives you that it's 1/2 of log of 1 plus square root 2. But here again, like, there is a bunch of things to believe. Just why is it level 0 and why is it related to the question for percolation? I mean, historically, people usually don't know that, but historically, actually, the first approach to proving PC equal 1/2 was through, well, the equivalent for the equivalent of the free energy for percolation, and try to prove that it has a singularity only at 1/2. So the equivalent of the free energy for the percolation model, you cannot take, you know, if you take log of 1, you are not going to get something very interesting, because the partition function for percolation is just 1. But in fact, it's a degenerate case, so you need to take the limit of something, and you will see that it's the average number of clusters per vertex. And this one has a trivial relation that the free energy at 1 minus p is equal to the free energy at p plus something. Something smooth. So that was this level zero of reasoning, was actually to try to, I mean, to use the duality in this sense for the free energy to try to guess that it's 1/2. This kind of, I mean, strategy to go through the free energy to get the result for percolation never really worked. In fact, it's much harder to study the free energy than to study all the other things. If you think about it, just for people who know who are a little bit more specialist, there is only one exponent that we do not know how to compute rigorously on Bernoulli percolation, even in 2D, even on the triangular lattice, for which we have conformal invariance and we have basically all the critical exponents. It's exactly how the free energy blows up, so the average number of cluster per site blows up when you approach PC. So it's really, I mean, somehow this free energy reasoning is really tough. But here, people were saved by Onzager, who said, well, okay, it's maybe difficult to prove, you know, like, why should there be a unique phase transition and things like that, you know. Let's just compute the free energy. Like that, it's simpler if we get an exact formula. And the amazing thing is that he managed to do it. So Onzager in 1944 just said, okay, well, the free energy of the Ising model is log 2 plus, I'm just writing it that you don't think this is a good idea to do that, okay? That, I mean, it's an excellent idea to try to compute it, but if you just want to compute the critical point, it's not the fastest way. So it's a double integral. And then we get, of course, the logarithm of cosh squared of beta minus sinh of beta times cos theta plus cos phi. I'm pretty sure you all had it in mind. And it also, by the way, if you are there, you can also just try to compute other things. And he also computed this thing and proved that it is something like 1 minus 1 over and the plus part of it. Isn't there? Yes, there is a power 4 and there is a power 1 over 8, sorry. Okay. So you can compute things explicitly. Well, so you can all go home, right, with this formula. So here, I mean, somehow there is something to be noticed, is that, I mean, it's an amazing achievement, but somehow it was very lucky in the first place, right, that there is a formula. Yes. There's absolutely no reason a priori that there would be a nice formula. And if, of course, if you reason, I mean, if you think a little bit more, there are actually deep reasons for that. But if you alter a little bit, if you change a little bit your lattice, or if you change a little bit your model, you lose this kind of magical property. So can we guess the 1 half log 1 plus square root 2 without going through these computations?
But if you change the lattice, you will also lose this formula for BC.
Yeah, but there are, in terms of qualitative behavior, you will get many, like, there are many things that the other techniques are going to give you which are still going to be true for other things. Okay. And a priori, I'm going to give you an example just after of a model for which you can compute the critical point, but you cannot compute the free energy for every beta. So it's not a if and only if. So there, somehow, you are lucky enough. But a priori, it's not clear. But indeed, this is very lattice dependent. That is very true. OK. What did I want to do? Ah. So let me try to give you another computation of that, and also to try to give you a unifying picture, how this is related to the other computation I try to highlight for percolation. Let's go there. So let's try to define a percolation type model which would encode geometrically the properties of the Ising model. This is called the Fortuyn-Castellan percolation. Sometimes it's called also the random cluster model. How many people saw the random cluster model? How many people never saw it? Ah, a little bit more. Okay, I'm progressing in the right direction. People know less and less. That's good. So let's do the following. So we are going to fix Q. And Q a priori could be larger than 0. But for the whole class, I'm going to take it larger or equal to 1. And since I don't want you to get confused, let's take it larger or equal to 1 right away. And P between 0 and 1. So what I want to do is for either 0 or 1, exactly like for the Ising model, I'm going to introduce the following measure. So it's a percolation measure. So it's exactly going to be like for percolation. So for a graph G which is equal to VE, the probability of a configuration omega. So omega is just an element of 0, 1 to the E. So it's a percolation configuration, open or closed for the edges. So I want it to be proportional to P to the number of edges in omega. I will denote it like that. So omega is a set of E such that omega E is equal to 1. One minus p to the number of closed edges in omega, or let's denote it like that, times q to the number of clusters in omega, all of this renormalized, where this is what? K0 of omega is the number of clusters in omega. So you just count the number of clusters. Notice that an isolated site is a cluster. Really, your graph omega, when I think of omega as a graph, I really think of the graph with same vertex set as G and with edge set given by the open edges. So an isolated site is a cluster. So if I want the measure with zero boundary conditions, I just take p to the number of edges, 1 minus p to the number of closed edges, q to the number of clusters. Notice that for q equal 1, you get 1 here. And this is just Bernoulli percolation, choosing at random an edge to be open or closed. And if I want the one boundary conditions, well, I do the same when, but with the additional thing that where all clusters touching the boundary of your graph. So remember G is, remember what I didn't write, that G here will be taken as a subgraph of Z2. So all the clusters touching the boundary are counted as one. So it's just a slightly different way of counting the clusters. And I mean, it's not going to be really the object of this class to tell you why it's interesting to do that. But you can define these measures, and exactly like for the Ising model, you can take the limit when g tends to infinity and define measures in infinite volume. So you can also define this thing, which are measures on Z2. Okay, so you have percolation measures on Z2. So what is the next question you want to ask? Is what is the critical point, if there is any? So define PC to be the to be such that theta of p, which I remind you is the probability, or let's even write it, that 0 is connected to infinity. Theta of p is equal to 0 if p smaller than pc, and is positive if p larger than pc. The question is, what is pc? Okay, so it's really for p, for q equal 1, you are exactly with Bernoulli percolation, and the question of computing PC is exactly what I devoted the whole hour, past hour, doing. Yeah?
Is it clear that there is monotonicity?
No. good point, but no. It's not clear, but it's not going to be so relevant. I'm going to exactly sweep this under the carpet and come back later at that, or maybe not. I will see. So it's not clear at all. It's not like for Bernoulli percolation where it's completely clear. Here you need to do something more. But it's not going to be so relevant for the discussion. So, okay, if you want, you can define, if you want it to be rigorous, you can define PC to be the infimum of the P for which theta of P is positive. That doesn't mean that for p larger than pc, you will always have theta of p positive, but at least it's indeed something well defined at this stage. OK, so theorem by Vincent Beffara and myself. Pc of q, so here maybe I'm remember that q is larger or equal to 1. So pc, which is going to be a function of q, is equal to square root q over 1 plus square root q. OK.
So why is it not obvious that it's monotonic, that the state of p is monotonic?
Just when you try to check that there is a coupling. So what does it mean monotonic? For instance, I mean, probability of increasing events should increase, right, with p. And when you check, it's not completely elementary to satisfy that. So for the percolation configuration, there is an obvious coupling between the two. You can really construct configuration at different p in such a way that omega p prime is really containing omega p for p smaller than p prime. And here, well, the obvious coupling for Bernoulli percolation just doesn't work. You need something more subtle. Actually, maybe I will present that, because it's a little bit related anyway to the proof that I will describe. So At a certain point, I can discuss this. It's a little bit like, I mean, it's not completely clear that for the Ising model, correlations increase. You need to prove, you need to have second Griffith inequality. So here, it's a little bit the same. It's, I mean, is there some kind of... So it's a very good question, and this is something I will not discuss too much. Okay, so let's go level zero of reasoning. Or maybe, yeah, right, level zero, which was a duality. So can we find here, can we guess first that this should be the right point? So proposition. Says the following: if omega is simple according to this guy, then omega star, right, the dual configuration, is simple according to the following measure. So it's going to be a random cluster measure with boundary condition 1, with parameter p star and q star that I'm going to tell you in a second. And on the graph g star, so what is the graph g star? So g star is a graph given by the set of edges E star, I mean by the set E star for E belonging to E. Like that. So you take all the edges of your original graph, you take the dual edges, these are the edges of your dual graph, and the vertices, you just take all the endpoints of these edges. So this is G star, and I need to tell you what Q star and P star are. So Q star, well, it's going to be equal to Q, simply. And P star, well, P star times P divided by 1 minus P star times 1 minus P is equal to Q. So this is a little bit more complicated. Just notice here, if you take Q equal 1, which again is simply Bernoulli percolation, this duality relation gives me what? P star equal 1 minus P. Okay, so it's coherent at least. For Q equal 1, you have a proof. And now we need to check whether we have a proof for other values. So let's go. Let's just maybe draw a small graph like that. Let's say this is G. And G star is this graph. Right? And notice that, so for this graph, I'm claiming that I'm going to count wired boundary condition, I mean boundary condition 1. So let me do this in my head. Let me kind of close up along the boundary, kind of connect all the vertices of the boundary of G star together via a path going around. Okay? Okay. So, what is the probability of omega? So the probability of omega is proportional to p over 1 minus p to the number of edges times q to the number of clusters. Right? It's the definition here. I mean, the 1 minus p to the number of edges is constant, right? It doesn't depend on the configuration, so just remove it and put it in this alpha sign, this proportionality sign. And this is also constant. So it's really proportional to p over 1 minus p to the number of edges times q to the number of connected components. Now let's try to write this to massage a little bit the equality, to try to get something which would be expressed in terms of the dual configuration instead of in terms of the configuration. So first thing, can I express the number of edges in omega in terms of the number of edges in the dual configuration? So this is the number of open edges. And by definition, it's exactly equal to the number, total number of edges minus number of closed edges. And the closed edges are exactly the open edges in the dual. So I have exactly that. So here, it will be proportional to at least 1 minus p over p to the number of dual edges for this part. Now, the number of connected components in omega. What do they correspond to in the dual graph? In the dual graph, these are exactly the faces of my dual graph. Right? If I look at the configuration, maybe I should make a drawing. So let's assume I have this and this. These are the open edges of my original graph. So my dual configuration here is going to be this, right? So in the dual graph, the connected components of a primary graph are exactly the faces of the dual graph. So this is the faces of the dual graph. But here I can use Euler formula to re-express this in terms of, well, other quantities of the dual graph. So this is going to be equal to the number of edges in my dual graph plus the number of connected components in my dual graph plus 1 minus the number of vertices in my dual graph. Right? Number of faces equal to number of edges plus number of connected components plus 1 minus number of vertices. If you never saw this inequality, I cannot do much for you. Now you can just prove it by induction, by starting with zero edges, and just it's a very simple induction. So when I'm going to put, when I'm going to replace this by this expression in terms of the dual edges, this and this is constant. It doesn't depend in the configuration, so it's going to be eaten by the proportionality sign. And I'm going to get, well, q to the number of connected components times q to the number of edges of the dual configuration times q to the number of connected components in the dual configuration. So here I'm going to have a q which pops up and a q to the number of connected components in the dual configuration. But my choice of p star instead of p gives me that this whole thing here is exactly equal to p star over 1 minus p star and this is what? This is just the probability of omega star, right? Excellent. So we have a duality relation. So now what do we do? Well, we look at the self-dual point, exactly as before. So this was a level two of our reasoning, was look, we were looking at 1/2 before. So here, look at p self-dual such that p self-dual star is equal to p self-dual. And if you compute p equal p star there, you get exactly that it's square root q over 1 plus square root q. So look at this value. And let's see what we can do at this value. So we can do exactly like before. We can look, for instance, at the crossing probability. Like that. Well, this is the same. I mean, I can look at the dual event. This is a little bit annoying, right? Okay. And this, I can use duality to express this in terms of the primal configuration, right? So it's exactly using duality. I know that the dual of this configuration, so it's in infinite volume, but just taking the limit when g tends to infinity there is going to give you the same duality relation for the infinite volume thing. So here it's going to be equal to this for the dual thing, which I could not put it if I want, but with zero boundary condition here, right? So here we are facing a small thing, which is that the measure here is not the same as the measure here, but there is a general fact, a little bit like the monotonicity that some of you mentioned earlier, that when p increases, you have more and more edges in your configuration. When you take, I mean, you can interpret the boundary conditions as being actually bigger for the one boundary condition than the zero boundary condition, because it's a little bit like exactly saying that these edges here are open, are present. So in fact, this measure is going to be bigger than this one. And this implies, so monotonicity, again, this is a very standard fact in the theory, tells you that in fact, crossing like that is larger than 1/2 and larger than 1/2. No, it's not driving me crazy at all. I cannot even imagine for you who are not responsible for it. Okay. So what do we do now? Well, first step is we do, okay, we are lucky because the proposition 1.2, the fact that the crossing probability is 10 to 1 when p is larger than pc, in fact, this argument was using so little of Bernoulli percolation that the same argument works for the Fortuyn-Castellan percolation. So proposition 1.2, adapted, of course, there is a little bit of work, but basically none, implies that for any p larger than pc, the crossing probabilities tend to 1. And you can even take the zero boundary conditions. So this automatically tells you what? It tells you that the self-dual point has to be smaller or equal to pc. So first, maybe I'm going to try only to write on these things, because I feel like my life is threatened, like one of you is going to just, you know, stop being able to bear it. And OK, so corollary, which is something like, oh, no, no corollary. So consequence, PC has to be larger or equal to P self-dual, which is square root Q over 1 plus square root Q. So this inequality, very easy. Question is, can we get an equivalent of the corollary 1.6 or something like that? Can we get the equivalent of the other inequality? And this is much less clear. But the argument with assuming exponential decay, this one was completely straightforward. If you have exponential decay, you just look at the crossing probabilities, you use the union bound, and you say, well, the probability of crossing is smaller than n times probability of being connected to distance n. It tends to zero. I'm done. So the corollary 1.6 also works. So it is sufficient to prove the property exp, to prove exponential decay. And now I hope I kind of motivated you enough. Actually, I will give you a last motivation later on. But that's a good question, is to try to prove this exponential decay in general. So theorem, due to myself, to Aran, Raoufi, and to Vincent Tassion, which is take fk, so q larger or equal to 1, take fk on zd, in fact, do not even restrict yourself to z2, do it on zd. Then you have exponential decay in subcritical. And the corollary of this is that you can compute the critical points for random cluster models, for Fortune-Castellan percolation. So just a little bit of history about this theorem. So maybe I should just write exactly. Then for any p smaller than pc, there exists cp positive such that pq you will see that in fact we prove something a little bit stronger, and that's important, but let's stay at this level for this lecture. So you get exponential decay. So a little bit of history on that. So when was it proved first and where? So first proof was for q equal 1, for Bernoulli percolation, by Kesten, basically, and d equal 2. So on z2, for q equal 1, Kesten managed to prove, when he proved that pc was equal to 1 half, he proved it, and in particular, he also proved exponential decay. So this was in the 80s. Then for q equal 1 and d larger or equal to 3, where it was proved by Menshikov, by Eisenman and Barsky in 86 and 87. So Menshikov in 86 and Eisenman Barsky in 87. There, I should say that there is a new proof, which is a proof that I will explain next time by Vincent Tassion and myself. Okay, now when q is equal to 2, we are going to see in a second that there is a connection to the Ising model. So there, somehow in this case, you can almost go back to Onzager. I mean, exponential decay of correlation in d equal 2 probably follows from the whole body of work that was done in this thing. I mean, I would actually not really know who first really stated the thing and prove it, but there you can do really much more anyway. You can in particular compute the best CP somehow. This you can compute it explicitly. So this I will explain to you why the Ising model is related to that. And for q equal 2 and d larger or equal to 3, I mean, okay, here I should say larger or equal to 2. Of course, it also works in dimension 2. The proof is by Eisenman, Barsky, and Fernandez in 87 as well. And maybe both are in 86 and this one in 87. Well, anyway, most of you were not even born at the time, so it doesn't count.
Doesn't this follow from
No. Reflection positivity only gives you
bound on the two-point function.
Yeah, but polynomial ones, not exponential. Yeah. at least to the best of my knowledge, the first proof is due to Eisenman, Barsky, and Fernandez. And there are also other cases which are Q very, very large compared to 1. So Q larger than a QC of D, much larger than 1. So in after a lot of work, you can do 25 in dimension 2, for instance. And it blows up very quickly with Q, with dimension. And here, think of it as a kind of perturbative argument. It's kind of so this is the first one to do were Kotecki and Schlossmann, and then there was work by Messager and co-author, so let's maybe not mention all of them. Okay, so this is basically what was known until a few years ago. And a few years ago, we did Q larger equal to 1 and D equal 2 with Befara and myself. So the theorem there, it was exactly, I mean, that's the only missing point, right? So the point was exactly to prove exponential decay for the two-dimensional random cluster model. And the ideas were actually very much based on this detour that I did earlier on in the class, where I was saying you can use this sharp threshold argument, this abstract theorem on the derivative. And there we use this in a crucial way. The point is that the argument was very planar, and that basically nothing was known for larger dimensions. And if you think this is isolated to because we are looking at a weird random cluster model and that's a weird idea in the first place, just take, so what is the closest to Bernoulli percolation you can think of? Just think of a model where, just instead of Bernoulli percolation, let's say you take two dependent models. So a model where the edge, the value of an edge, is not independent of the other edges, but it's independent of any edge at distance 2 of it. Even this model was not known. We had no clue how to get exponential decay in any dimension. So that's exactly, I mean, and I will explain to you why next week, because I will do the proof for Bernoulli percolation. You are going to see it's very short, it's very cute. Oh, yeah, we are very happy. I was very happy, at least. But then you will really see that there is one place which really depends on the independence, basically.
Of course, at high temperatures, it probably was known, but it was not known that it extends all
yes.
the way to the crystal.
Exactly. So here you have a very good point. The perturbative regime, they were known for a very long time. So P very close to zero, this is known. Actually, it's very simple to do. You can really, for random cluster model, it's extremely simple. The model at some P with a parameter Q larger or equal to 1 is smaller than the model with Q equal 1 at the same P. And for P smaller than 1 over the degree, it's extremely simple to prove exponential decay for Bernoulli percolation. So this indeed was known, but here the whole game is to try to get something up to the critical point. So all the counting arguments do not work anymore. Let me say that there are many applications of this result. So here, once you have this, actually the slightly stronger form, you can prove many things. You can prove mixing properties of your model. You can prove Ornstein-Zernike estimates. So you can really get the two-point function, really understand how they decay, even get equivalents for them. So it's not going to decay like an exponential. It's going to decay like an exponential times a polynomial correction, and you can understand this polynomial correction. You can also know at which speed the mixing, I mean, you can bound the spectral gap of the dynamics that are naturally associated to this model. And in some sense, the Fortuyn-Castellan percolation was almost like, I mean, one of the big successes of this model is that it gives a very good algorithm to sample the POTS model. Well, it gives a very good algorithm if you know, I mean, at least theoretically, at the theoretical level, it's good only if you know that it mixes fast. And that's one of the things that you can prove using that. Okay. What else did I want to do? Ah, so in the last 15 minutes, I completely forgot the break, but that's fine, right? I mean, nobody wanted a coffee or anything like that. So anyway, end of the thing, I want to give you a last motivation, which is how do we relate Ising and percolation? Because so far, I didn't tell you. So, last motivation, let's look at last class of models. And let's see the connection. So D it's only 10 minutes left. Hold it with me. POTS models. So it's a generalization of the Ising model. It's exactly the same definition as above, so it's good that it stayed on the board. It's a lucky one. I didn't do it on purpose. Which is just, instead of doing sigma in 0, 1, in minus 1, 1, I'm just going to take the spins to be colors among a set of q colors, so q integers. You define exactly the same thing for any boundary condition like that. You define the Hamiltonian and the measure. You take the limit when g tends to infinity, and it gives you a Gibbs measure, which is just a measure of random coloring of the plane, of Z2. OK. And theorem. Sigma x, sigma y, I should tell you what this means here. So here, sigma x, sigma y, you just replace it by indicators, and sigma x is equal to sigma y, OK? Is not equal to sigma y, OK? So the larger is equal, sorry. So the, excellent. So I'm completely lost, of course. Where am I? Anyway. Theorem. By Befara and myself, which is very much like the theorem there. So this was the theorem above was 1.10 there. And this is 1.11. And it says that beta c, which you can define, which I'm going to define in a second, is log of 1 plus square root q. And beta c is defined such that when I look, so I'm going to denote the measure with the measure with a q for the q state POTS model. If I look at the measure with boundary condition 1, and I look at the probability that sigma 0 is equal to 1, well, this, I want to compare it to what it would be if I would be without any interaction. So I will compare it to 1 over q. Right? If this guy was sampled uniformly, it would be 1 with probability 1 over q. Well, this thing, I want this equal 0 if beta smaller than beta c, and positive if beta is larger than beta c. Well, the claim is that beta c is equal to log of 1 plus square root q. So notice for q equal 2, you recover the Ising model, right? 1, 2, or plus or minus is the same. The reason why you don't get the same beta c is just because before I was doing sigma x times sigma y, which was 1 if they are equal, and minus 1 if they are not equal. So there was a factor 2 in the Hamiltonian, which is exactly popping up there. OK, and right, that's the theorem. And the goal of this lecture, so this was known for q equal 2. It was known for q very large by the same argument as here. In fact, that was exactly what was proved here. And the last theorem I want to mention is a theorem by myself, Raoufi and Tassion, which is, well, for this model, you have the equivalent of this thing here, which is for any beta smaller than beta c, there exists a c beta such that the thing decays exponentially fast. Okay, let's put sigma x, sigma y, in x. So the correlation between two guys decays exponentially fast. Okay, so what is the connection between this and the result that I mentioned before? Well, the connection is going to come from a very simple coupling, and that's going to be the five last minutes of the class, which is that you can relate the random cluster model and the POTS model. So corollary 1 point, I mean, proposition, sorry. So do the following. Imagine you have a configuration omega, which is simple according to the random cluster measure. Let's take free boundary conditions. It's going to be simpler. And let's do the following. Color each cluster uniformly at random. Okay, so what does it mean coloring? Just for any cluster in omega, choose a color uniformly. And just do, for any x in your graph, sigma x equals sigma c, where x belongs to the cluster c. Okay, so it's a coloring of the connected component of your graph. Okay? Do that. Now you have a random coloring of your graph, where the claim is that sigma is, in fact, simple according to the POTS measure. So if q is an integer, with 1 minus p equal exponential of minus beta. So the beta is related to the p. Now notice that, and you have the same thing, so that's the first point, and the same thing if omega is simple to, according to this measure, then, and that you fix. So here in this case, you are just going to do something different. You are going to say that all the clusters that are touching the boundary, you give automatically the color 1, with sigma c equal 1 if c intersects the boundary. Then sigma is simple according, or let's say color I. Then sigma is simple according to the POTS measure, with parameter g, beta q, and boundary condition I. So before I prove the thing, why is this proposition good? Well, it kind of gives us a dictionary between the random cluster model and the POTS model. In particular, for instance, if I want to understand what is, well, let's say, what is this thing? Well, I can look in the coupling whether 0 is connected to the boundary or not. So it's going to be probability in the ground coupling that sigma 0 equals 1 and 0 is connected in omega to the boundary, plus probability in the ground coupling that sigma 0 is equal to 1, but in the case where 0 is not connected to the boundary. Right? This is just trivial. So far, I didn't do anything smart. But now, notice that if zero is connected to the boundary, so I'm in the second procedure, the color of the cluster is necessarily one. So here, I can forget about this condition and just say the probability that zero is connected to the boundary. It's automatic on this event. Now, on this event, when I'm not connected to the boundary, I mean another cluster. Therefore, the color of this cluster is chosen completely at random. So the conditional probability of having color 1, if I have that, is 1 over q. So all this is to say this is p gpq 1 of 0 connected to the boundary plus 1 over q probability that it's not connected to the boundary, which this is 1 over q plus q minus 1 over q or something like that. I'm necessarily going to, I guess this is OK. Thing like that. Now let g tends to infinity. This was with g, sorry. Let g tends to infinity. This is going to be equal to mu beta q 1 of sigma 0 equal 1. And this is going to converge to probability that 0 is connected to the boundary of the box. But when the box is going to infinity, I'm going to get that 0 is in an infinite cluster. So that tells me automatically that having this larger or equal to 1 over q is equivalent to having this positive. So if I compute the critical point of the random cluster model, if I prove the theorem that I this time erased on the critical point of the random cluster model, I get automatically the critical point of the random cluster of the POTS model. Okay. 2 minutes is going to be a little bit short, but let's just finish the proof because it doesn't make sense to postpone this to the next time. But I hope, I mean, you can also look probabilities at sigma 0 equals sigma x and just see that it's expressed in terms of probabilities that 0 are connected to x in the cluster, in your random cluster model. So if you understand all these things, you will understand the POTS model. And in particular, for q equal 2, the critical point of the Ising model, you can understand it as the corresponding value for the self-dual point of the random cluster model with q equal 2. Okay, the proof is actually very short. So except that it's not this one. So take P, the coupling between sigma and omega. And let's say that omega is compatible with sigma if omega xy equal 1 implies sigma x equals sigma 1. Right, in the coupling, the construction of the coupling is made in such a way that if you are in the same connected component, you will automatically get the same spin. So my coupling will only charge, will only give positive probability to pairs omega sigma, which are compatible. Right? So now, for the probability of this, what do I get? So I need to sample sigma omega first, so it's 1 over z. Let's do it with the zero boundary condition. Omega 0 g pq, p to the number of edges, 1 minus p to the number of closed edges, q to the number of connected components. Excellent. So this is the probability of omega. And now I need to add the probability of sigma conditioned on omega. Right? What is this probability? For each connected component, I'm choosing one color at random. So for here, to get exactly the configuration sigma, that I'm going to get exactly this conditional probability. These two things cancel each other. And here, I should not forget that I need the indicator function that omega is compatible with sigma. And I get that the joint law of the two is proportional to p to the number of edges, 1 minus p to the number of closed edges, times indicator that omega is compatible with sigma. So what do I need to do to conclude? I need to resum on omega to see what is the probability of 1 sigma. Okay? So for fixed sigma, let E sigma be the set of edges with sigma x not equal to sigma y. Why do I want to introduce this set? Because, well, if omega and sigma are compatible, what does it mean in terms of E sigma? It exactly means that omega E must be equal to 0 for any E in E sigma. So sigma, omega compatible with sigma, it's exactly equivalent at, for every edge in E sigma, omega E is 0. It's exactly that. So here, the probability of sigma, it's a sum over omega compatible with sigma of the probability of omega sigma. So it's going to be the sum over omega compatible with sigma. So when I look at this thing here, I know that for any edge which is in E sigma, omega E must be equal to 0. So the contribution here is going to be 1 minus P to the E sigma, right? These guys, you are certain they are close. And then for the other guys, for the value of the other edges, well, they can be open or closed. It's, at random. Both are compatible. So omega restricted to E minus E sigma is really arbitrary. And I'm looking at P to the omega, let's call it omega prime. This thing is equal to what? It's just equal to 1. So I get overall that the whole thing is equal to 1 minus p to the e sigma. 1 minus p, I chose it to be equal to e to the minus beta. So this is e to the minus beta. And the size of this is what? It's just the value of, it's the number of pairs of neighbors which have different spins. It was exactly the energy of my configuration. Well, here I wrote it with equal spins, but you could have written it with different spins. So it's exactly the same. And I get exactly that the distribution of sigma is the Potts model distribution. So this is the end of this first class. So next week we will focus on Bernoulli percolation. First, give you a kind of candy with a cute proof of exponential decay. A little bit different, by the way, than what is usually done. So we were happy to find an even smaller simplification. And then we will dive into a proof which is not very long either, maybe 3 or 4 pages, but a little bit less elementary. But this proof, we will jump on it for the next lecture. So the third lecture, and prove that this proof extends, in fact, to any random cluster model, but also to a large class of other models that you can think of. Thank you for attending, and hopefully see you next week for those who are courageous enough. Thank you very much.